But something is like, would you rather be looking at a wall or would you rather be in a closet?
I'd rather.
Yeah, and hopefully my student can say that. Oh, no, or choose that. We're just talking about this one, because I don't know. I was just talking about this one. They'll just let the students know.
My school is kind of the opposite. We're like really academic. Sometimes it's too much.
So I don't recall that.
Expectation for, you know, students' participation and behavior.
I get that. Yeah, our school, they have a lot of expectations. It tends to be very academic expectations where when you're in a language classroom, you know, getting people to respond to you can be hard. That's the culture.
Granted, but the academic side of that will help keep the behavioral problems in check, because at least those students, are, even if they don't want to participate per se, they still will focus on, you know, the academic side of it. But at least they can still read and do some of the skills without necessarily speaking out.
Sure. Something is better than nothing. I agree. All right. So I did have another question here. Every one of your sixth grade classes has a boy or girl who doesn't know their ABCs and insists upon saying, "I don't know," in Taiwanese every time you ask them a question. How do you motivate them to take a class, or the class, more seriously? Were there any thoughts on this one? Somebody who's given, how would you motivate them? Now, could you go into maybe more detail on the game? How is the game going to get them involved?
Just as simple as lining them up and writing ABCs on the board, each one of them.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I have a game that I, sorry, I'll get you in a second. I have a game that I like to play called Relay, where the students run up to the board, write a letter or word, and then run back. They do it as a team, so like this row is a team, and they just go up, back and forth to the board. And that can help a lot of kids get into the ABCs or whatever the problem is. I'm sorry, you were going
to
say?
I was going to say, to me, this is differentiation. I mean, if a student doesn't know something and they don't feel comfortable, find ways to small group or empower them to get those foundation skills rather than just hearing, "I don't know."
Yeah. And you're always going to have to make a judgment call. Is this person really not knowing, or have they just given up? When you get to the sixth grade, and I emphasize sixth grade here, a lot of kids have just kind of signed up. They know the junior high is coming. They know it's around. All I have to do is sit here. Literally just sit here until June, and then I'm free. So they'll hit you with, "I don't know," a lot. So something to think about. Maybe so-and-so genuinely doesn't know, and your reaction's going to be good. Yes, sir?
I don't know if this applies to ABCs, but I just have like a ritual where they would have topics, like food, for instance, and I would play a memory game, like working on groups, like the set, and then they would have to start off with, let's say we take an elephant with an animal that starts with an A, and they have 5 minutes to practice, and they can say alligator, and the next year I say alligator and baboon, alligator, baboon, cat, and then they have to remember. And it sounds like it's very difficult, but they get really into it because they practice together and they try to. If they can go all the way, maybe the ABCs, and I would give them like bonus points. Sometimes just the group that gets the furthest or gets the most. Like those names, and I would give them like extra points, and give the other people points as well.
Sure, that sounds like a great idea. And again, the amount of novelty, the amount of fun in the game determines that too. If you've done hangman every class first semester, you can't expect that to be a motivating factor anymore. It's just not. So, did you have something to say?
Yeah, one thing I found, like, kind of surprisingly useful last year was, yeah, like you said, the sixth graders, sometimes they're a little bit of a lost cause. But the fourth and fifth graders, when we did activities that were, because some kids, their English is not good, but they might be really good at playing a musical instrument.
Yeah.
So we did like an activity where they had to listen to different instruments and try to indicate which instrument was making the sound.
Yeah,
and
playing the strings.
Yeah, and the kids who were really good at orchestra, like, they just came out of their shell and tried to identify it. Or we did an activity where they had to listen to the sentences I was reading, and they had to be able to draw exactly how I said where the chair was, the apples on the chair or something on
yes.
the picture. And then the girl who never talks in class, but she's really artistic, she was able to draw really quickly. So there's no way that you could draw it as quickly as I say it. So the other people helped memorize what I said and then told her what to draw. So then I think, yeah, kind of just playing to the strengths of the younger kids, because they have stuff that they're really good at as well.
Did you have something to add?
I just wanted to add, like, kind of on something that a lot of people have said already with this, but one thing that I would do is just, and perhaps some might consider it a sign of weakness with students depending on where they are on a personal level, but just show them that you care, like take that seriously, and be like, you know, whether it's individually or as a class, and if you see a weakness, be like, guys, I want you to learn this because this is going to help you. I want to help you for your future. When you get to the junior high, it's going to be a lot more challenging than the ending, and I'd really like to see and help you improve. And I need you know, your effort, but I'm here too to help you. And so, I mean, I would try to reach them on a personal level. If the class is small enough, you can talk to that individual, but if it's a class thing too, then so be it. You can address that in class. But I think showing sincerity is not a bad thing.
Yeah, I think that's almost an overriding consideration too. Are you a positive or a negative factor in that person's life? Not just for you as a teacher, but for you as a person. Because I don't think any of us get paid enough to be a bad thing in somebody's life. You know, if you're doing something in class and it's making some kid's life miserable, regardless of whether that kid's activities are positive or negative, you're probably doing the wrong thing. Nobody needs that level of stress. So just being a positive person in somebody's life, I think is very, very important. Okay, comments? There's one more. You have a class in which several students always arrive late. How do you fix the situation? Everybody's late. Yes?
I give them each piece of paper on the desk, and then I put a riddle on the board, and I give them time to sort of solve it, and the longer they take, the less time they have to solve it. And each student that gets it right, I use a lot of the point system, so then let's say 16 and team, 10 kids in team 1 got it right, 8 kids in team 2 got it right, and I give them points 10 and 8. So this helps them to know that
sure, and making time a factor in class is always important. Keeping your eyes on the clock, being aware how many minutes you have for every activity, when do we start? If you finish early, what can you do? Those kind of things can be important. Any other thoughts here? No? Okay. Oh, did you? Sorry. I cut you off.
Maybe talk to the teacher who had them beforehand. Maybe she keeps them longer or takes away from their break or whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, it could be another.
Just keeping that communication open and knowing what the other people do. You can save yourself a lot of time and trouble that way too. Next question, I believe this is the last one. You are doing an art activity and many of the students say, I can't draw. This happens to me all the time. I hear this several times a day. and then do the laziest job possible. How do you get them to art? Now, before I get to you, sir, we will get there. I do art a lot. I tend to divide my class into academic activities, physical activities like ball games, and then art. So, yeah, you'll draw comic books, and you'll have the sixth graders going, you know what? I can't draw. Why don't I just make the ugliest thing you've ever seen and hand it into you? How do you improve that? Go ahead.
That's happened to me a lot. I can draw, or I don't think I can draw. So I would have them vote. I would have vote yes, and I would ask them if they think they can draw it. Say no. Someone goes up and sit down. And I say, well, I think I can draw it, but I'm gonna try it. And I draw it, and they stop that and say, what's that supposed to be? Nothing. That's supposed to be a ball. That's not a ball, teacher. Okay, but you try it. Show me how to look at it. And let's get some stuff on the board.
You set the bar low, and then they're like, I can do better than that. You know, that can always help. Another thing I've found is they have art books that you can buy where they draw things line by line. So if you have kids that say they can't draw, you can just Xerox and copy the book and give them, here's a mouse, and you just have to draw the mouse line by line. It gives people a sense of confidence. So you can find the books anywhere. Okay? So, this again was the part I was kind of weak on, so I'm reaching back here. If anyone has any thoughts and would like to jump in, feel free. Co-teachers and how to get along with them. Okay, so first thing, be friendly but professional. You want to be careful as a man or as a woman of sexual harassment situations. This is becoming a bigger and bigger thing in Taiwan. Not just for men, but for women. So you really want to be aware, where's the line I can cross? Where's the line I can't cross? Where can I touch people? Where can I not touch people? What can I say? What can I not say? What can I compliment someone on? And what can I not compliment someone on? And gender, sexual orientation, it always plays in there. I've seen this happen with men and women. We had a woman at a school, it got really weird for her because her Taiwanese co-workers were always trying to take her on dates, and that got super strange and super uncomfortable. And if she had said no to a lot of things in the beginning, that situation would not have happened. Because she was new, and she was a little bit scared, and she didn't know who to talk to. The situation just blew up like a balloon. So you want to be aware of your boundaries, also other people's boundaries. Culturally speaking, Taiwanese people are cool with some things, and not cool with other things. It's going to be different for you. I see boys grab each other by the balls all the time.
Yeah.
It just happens, you know? And I'm not gonna stand in the corner and go, that's inappropriate, you know? You can't do that, but people have different comfort zones, so tread carefully. Be open and not judgmental. I think when I've seen people get into trouble, usually the first warning sign is them being judgmental. If you're new to a place, if you're new to a culture, if you're new to a job, I would just suspend judgment on almost everything for a while. Not forever, but going into your school acting like maybe a mature five-year-old wouldn't be that bad. You know, you could baby step your way into the school. And dealing with other cultures, of course, that's only amplified because people are coming from different places and it doesn't always make sense. I always think that everyone does what they do for a reason. Nobody's going to do something that is just completely irrational. Everybody's coming from somewhere. So if you just can suspend your sense of judgment for a while in the beginning, make efforts to keep the conversation going. This happens to a lot of people in the course of a year, which is a long time, or can be a long time. People tend to put up barriers with each other. You know, I'm only going to say hi to you in the morning. I'm not going to say goodbye to you at night. I'm only going to talk to you about sports. I'm not going to talk to you about my relationships. And those kind of things are natural, and people get in a rhythm. But if you can try to keep the conversations open, not, you know, intrusive, but open, and talk about different things, your coworkers, you'll be happier, they'll be happier. Again, there's the specter of sexual harassment, but, you know, if you can kind of be open and friendly, it's always good. And making efforts to learn about the people you're with, their culture, their language is always a plus. There's different ways of doing that. It's kind of up to you. I've seen a lot of people go through the first semester, everything's great, but then they get to May, and they're just burned out. They're counting the minutes until the year's over, and they don't have anything to say to anybody they're working with. So you just want to think about what kind of barriers you're putting out to people. It's always good. And the last one, always important, be on time, be ready, and know your responsibilities. A lot of people get really relaxed where I live. It's Taidong, there's just not a lot going on. You know, people go surfing, people like that, people, I don't want to say what people smoke, but people get very relaxed, and it tends to make them slow after a while, but this will really cost you something. So make an effort to be on time. Warning! Okay, this one, Alex had me put this in because I had totally forgotten about it. But some schools use evaluation committees to evaluate your job performance. One or more of your co-teachers may be part of this committee. You may want to ask co-teachers where and when these evaluations will take place. You may also want to ask how you can improve after each evaluation. This is a very, very, very important thing for you. When you start your job, if it's a new school, talk to your co-teacher, the one whose sort of job it is to watch you. When is your evaluation? Who's going to be there? What time is it? You can get blindsided by this a lot. I've seen people have a really bad relationship with their co-teacher and then find out that co-teacher is evaluating them later. Like, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. You know, so really make sure you know who's on board with that, when it's going to take place. And again, yes, how can I do better? It's really hard for people to say anything to. If you just jump in at the end with, how can I do better? They will tell you, and if they don't tell you, I would consider yourself fine. Okay? Issues I've had with co-teachers, and this is over a long period of time, so things they have to explain Taiwan to me. I don't get this much anymore, but people can use Taiwan as an excuse for a lot of stuff. They can come at you with anything and say, oh, that's just how we do it in Taiwan. That's just how parents are in Taiwan. That's what kids eat in Taiwan.